Welcome to HD Nation, your guide to the best in HD content and the best in home theater gear, no matter what your budget is. I'm Patrick Norton.
And I'm Robert Herron.
A lot of great stuff coming up in today's show, including the long-awaited roundup of all, well, darn near all of the calibration, DIY calibration discs.
All the important ones.
For HD TVs.
The ones we recommend, have talked about, and some stuff you probably haven't seen yet.
You've spent a lot of time with these discs.
Years.
Years. Thousands of hours. But in sad news for all you animation and anime fans out there, the legendary animator, the man, the myth, the storytelling legend behind Spirited Away, Howl's Moving Castle, My Neighbor Totoro, Ponyo, which I'll mention, although Roger, our producer, hates it. My son loves it. In any case, Miyazaki has announced his retirement at a news conference at the Venice Film Festival. President of Studio Ghibli, Koyo Hoshino, said details would be announced later at a news conference in Tokyo. The Wind Rises, which has been playing in Japan since July, with Miyazaki's last film, tells the fictionalized tale of the man behind the design of World War II Japan's Mitsubishi Zero. A little bit different from Miyazaki.
Kind of cool.
But yeah, I mean, dude.
It's a moment in time.
Yeah. So thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Enjoy your retirement. And if you want to come back, we'll be watching.
Always.
Just saying.
Now, hey, here at the HD Nation, we are always talking about display calibration and the need for good test patterns in order to accurately verify or adjust a TV's picture controls.
There's a little more green, it'll be fine. I can see these things.
You know, also in the case of a speaker setup too, there are also discs with test sounds to verify the installation and to achieve a balanced output as well. Right. But we're going to focus on more on the video side. Now, test discs used to be the DVDs and now Blu-rays of arcane-looking video charts and those technical sound samples, but now there are more consumer-friendly options like the THX Tune-Up app for iOS, which has been out for a little while now. We've mentioned a lot of these on the show before, things like the Spears & Munsell Blu-ray Benchmark Disc. There's now a version 2 of that that I have here as well. There's the new version 2, version 1. Also, the Disney WOW disc, that is one of our favorites as well, as far as a more consumer-friendly disc that also has some narration with Goofy, which I find very cool. The Digital Video Essentials HD Basics disc is another one that's been out there for a while as well that is considered a classic, so to speak. And in the player, I actually have the AVS 709 disc as well. That's available from the good folks at AVS Forums. Mm-hmm. And the nice thing
about you download and burn yourself.
Totally. It comes in a couple of different formats, either for Blu-ray or if you don't have a Blu-ray drive, you can get one that's a DVD version that has similar materials. My do-it-yourself disc as well. It has some of my favorite movie scenes on it that I actually put together myself. Mm-hmm. And that really comes down to it. Some also material you might not have actually heard of, including one that's just a general classic as well, the Microsoft's DVD Test Annex. This was a reference disc that just about every disc maker, be it or player, be it software or hardware-based manufacturer, will take this disc and ensure that their player is doing the correct things with it. Used a lot to test DVDs and less so with Blu-ray players nowadays. Samsung even put out their own reference disc in here. I have it buried in there somewhere. A beautiful disc, actually, their first edition disc, actually authored by one of my engineer friends over at Samsung. This is great. It actually focuses a lot on natural color, a lot of skin tones in this one. It's also on contrast as well as video processing. I like the contrast bits because it has everything from extreme dark with extreme white detail in it, in addition to things like outdoor scenes at night with everything from fireworks displays to other things as well. THX, of course, they're in this. They have actually their own calibrator disc right there. This includes a little bit of everything, including the optimizer program. You can't actually buy that disc, as far as I know. This is one they put out specifically for the folks that go through their calibrator training sessions. It does include that optimizer disc that you might see on DVDs and Blu-rays you get with certain DVDs and Blu-rays that you get in commercials, or I should say with movies and things like that.
Right.
Now, some older stuff that I still use is the HQV Benchmark 2.0 disc. That's actually right there. I just want to say it has been a great tool over the years. It's still an effective tool, and there goes the disc on the floor anyway. But the company's no longer making this anymore. Right. And there's one last one I just want to point out that you probably might not have heard of, but it gets mentioned a lot, and that's the FPD Benchmark disc. There it is. I think I see it right there. This one. This is probably FPD Benchmark software, real great name there. This is probably the software that prompted all the LCD manufacturers to make 120 hertz and faster panels because this really highlights it. I think this was specifically made by the plasma folks to highlight the picture performance you get out of a plasma display compared to other flat panel displays in terms of how fast the pixels can update and how well it deals with things like motion. And now that we're way deep into the LCD side of things.
The shortlist, though, I think would probably be one of these two discs for most of the people watching right now.
I think those are two world-class discs. Actually, on the WOW disc in particular, it is a, I think, a more consumer-friendly disc, but it also incorporates a lot of very high-end tests as well. Very advanced test patterns if you really want to dig into it, and also some of the more easy ones to use. I particularly like their contrast and brightness setup on that disc as well.
So I just want to warn you, it's good, you need to know this, but you will see this stuff everywhere.
Totally, and the bottom line really is that test discs like these, they're tools that are used as reference materials to compare what the display is showing to a, quote, known picture. Right. What's on the disc has been created, hopefully, in a very pristine environment. It's going to be as good as it can be as far as, you know, displaying color or detail. And then you're basically using these to make sure that your display is showing off the whole fully detailed picture with no loss of quality and hopefully accurate color. And coming up soon, we'll go over the most important settings in your TV to make sure that your setup is right.
And it's one of the reasons it's really nice to have the Blu-rays, because this is one of the best possible ways to actually know what the video should look like when it's done right.
Totally.
I love watching video online, but it tends to be squish.
It's our best sources.
So you're going to do an actual setup right now, a calibration?
Totally. Just at least show off the beginning of how to do it, a tool you can use that you can download for free, and to go over one of the basic settings, a couple of the basic settings that a TV has. And to do that, I've got a wonderful disc. We're talking about that AVS HD 709 disc that you can download. Well, that's what I have in the player going. But before we get into talking about specific settings, let's talk about what you should learn to get familiar with your TV. And it really doesn't matter if your TV is fresh out of the box or it has given you years of viewing pleasure. Every television provides a set of controls that can be used to produce a better, more accurate looking picture. Now, the right connection to use, HDMI, the high-definition multimedia interface. If you have that connector in the back of the device you want to connect to your TV, and your TV has that port as well, which it should, use it, always. And if you're unsure of what the TV has as far as settings go, maybe somebody's been messing with it, reset that sucker. And when you do reset a TV, always select the home mode to ensure you're not using the store mode, which can cause other issues as well. Start with your picture presets. These are basically preset picture modes that are built into all TVs, things like movie, cinema, dynamic, vivid. Note how they affect the various picture settings. Take a look at the settings as you're going through those different modes and note what they're tweaking along the way. Now, movie mode or a user mode is a great place to start and experiment, as it really will hopefully turn off most of the heinous picture enhancements that are usually enabled by default. Now, we'll start with a basic calibration. We'll go over what some of the picture controls do. We'll start with overscan. Overscan is really just a control of the scale of the video picture, how big or small that picture is on the screen relative to the screen size. Sharpness setting, that's all about edge enhancements, and the lack thereof is usually a good place to be. You want to basically turn those down so you don't see unnatural enhancements, yet at the same time you want it up high enough to where it's not causing any problems.
I love the overscan disc simply because it's like, if you can't see that line, you have overscan issues.
Totally.
And if you have, you know, if all you can see is this blue or it says 5% overscan and you can't see the 2.5 and the no overscan, you got work to do.
That's really nice. And it's usually just a quick setting in the TV to switch that back and forth. You know, for standard def content, it might not be ideal, but for your high def sources, that's the way to go, is 0% overscan on that picture. And generally, keep your sharpness settings low. That's another reason I mentioned too about having the picture presets and go through those. Some of the presets like vivid or even standard will really crank up the sharpness level and you can really see the difference on a screen or on a test pattern like this. And by going with say the movie preset or the user preset where typically the sharpness setting's much lower, you can then basically get a good A and B back and forth without having to dig into the picture settings themselves. Now, next time, we'll show you how to verify your TV's brightness and contrast settings to get the most pop out of your picture.
Blu-ray picks of the week of September 3rd, 2013 include a new 20th anniversary release of The Fugitive. New scan, finally, people, 1080p AVC MPEG 4, not the MPEG 2 that was pretty much the DVD version from 2006. A new scan, this is awesome, 50 gigabyte disc. High Def Digest has a great write-up on it. They'll tell you which box to look for to find the right one, the new one, and, oh, what's that? Star Trek Into Darkness is next week. I don't want to get into that.
Wow.
The people are either loving this movie or not loving the way it looks on Blu-ray, and I'll let you read the reviews. But exciting one this week, there it is. Scanners is a UK version of the David Cronenberg classic that apparently looks gorgeous, and if you are a fan of Cronenberg's sci-fi horror thing, keep a lookout for this one. You're probably going to be buying that for a pretty penny from Amazon UK. And let's see it. Oh, hey, it's only £15. plus delivery.
What is that, $30?
$30, give or take.
A little more?
A little more. Just a smidge. It's hard to tell this
week. I need my David Cronenberg.
Oh, my goodness. You love watching people's heads blow up. At Donsky1 tweeted at Robert Herron, could you talk about DLP TV on HD Nation? I know they've gotten a bad rap, but Mitsubishi WD5773-1 is working perfectly.
I remember that set. I think I reviewed it.
It was a rear projection, right?
Oh, yeah.
Big old box.
Mitsubishi, baby.
People mocked those, but they just lasted forever. And at Robert Herron, he says, I believe they produced the best blacks for super contrast. Have had mine since 2007. Only had to replace the lamp twice. First of all, it's hard to talk smack about a TV that's provided years of good service. There were, back in the day, years and years ago, there were occasionally like rainbowing or halo-y artifacts in some of the early DLPs. But if you're not seeing them, you're good. And DLP is pretty sophisticated stuff.
Totally. DLP stands for Digital Light Projection. And here's one of those little chips we were just talking about. This actually is a system that directs a light source, the lamp module, towards this chip-like device that features a face of tiny hinged micro mirrors. Now, each mirror represents at least one on-screen pixel when angled toward the screen. The mirror reflects a pixel's worth of light onto the rear of the screen. And when the mirror is angled away, that light is then being blocked from reaching the screen, making black. That's essentially one or the other. And if you modulate it, do it really quickly, which these chips do move very fast, you can then scale the gray as bright or as dark as it needs to be to produce that.
I mean, literally, it's like a signal mirror from your, you know, from your survival kit, where the each individual
that
transistor,
they even look a
mirror,
lot like that.
No mirror, mirror, no mirror, mirror. It's the weirdest thing.
Thousands of times a second, they're able to flip. So there are other tricks too. But rear projection DLP TVs like Donald's Mitsubishi share some of the visual characteristics with LCD televisions. Actually, they produce a very bright picture from straight on. And when viewed off-axis, you have basically loss of light and other viewing issues as well. But my big concern really with rear projection is overscan. That's the one that really pushed me away from the technology faster than everything, was the fact that you really can't see a one-to-one picture on a screen like that at 1080p or beyond anyway. Mm-hmm. Also, DLP TVs are using a single chip as far as the projection display system goes. White light is directed as it's flying through the system through a spinning color filter to produce the colors that we see on the screen. And color breakup, or the rainbow artifacts that Pat mentioned, are part of the problem. And also, a decrease in brightness if you compare that to, say, three-chip systems. Mm-hmm. The commercial cinema projectors that use DLP chips are actually using three to process red, blue, and green separately. They're very efficient and also very, very bright that way. With a single chip system, you're only processing one particular color at any given moment, so you're basically losing two-thirds of the light, potential light that could be possible.
So rear projection systems are fundamentally gone. You're not, unless you can repair your rear projection system if nobody's making them anymore. Front projectors, is anybody making consumer-priced three-chip front projectors?
No.
Okay.
No, I mean, under $10,000, yes. There's a couple out there, but most of them quickly get into the DLP anyway. Mm-hmm. When we talk three-chip LCD projectors, those are actually quite affordable. They go down to, I believe, almost $1,000 now. But that's really one of the main issues now. If you can keep your TV running, you know, by all means, all it's costing you is an occasional bulb replacement, lamp module replacement once in a while. But the reason we're really not talking about them anymore is nobody else is making them. Yeah. Mitsubishi stepped out of the business. Their last TVs were actually utilizing lasers instead of light sources. So it's still using a DLP chip, but instead of that light path going through a spinning color filter, this was just pure red, blue, green laser light hitting this chip and being reflected onto the back of the screen. Now, rear projection is not dead by any means. There are plenty of front projector systems that are used to create rear projection setups. Mm-hmm. If you can't see the projector in a room that's lighting up a screen somewhere, chances are it's being shot from behind, and the screens are transparent enough to provide that kind of viewing angle. And a lot of high-end installations nowadays are actually using rear projection setups to create very similar large screen displays, either in the home or commercial installations as well. And there's nothing bad about that kind of rear projection, other than that some of the setup's kind of interesting in terms of you got to think about, you know, how far away are you going to need to put the projector to get the image you need, and in that case you might have to bounce it off a special mirror or other devices as well to create the sized image you're going to be doing. It's there, but it's easier to shoot it from the front.
Short answer is we like DLP. It's good stuff.
It's also very reliable, and they're doing these in 4K digital cinema projectors now. The thing is that I really want three-chip systems four DLP, and those are a little pricey. But
you want a three-chip system, four DLP for under $2,000.
Our friends at Digital Projection, we'll have to call them up and get their new, I think they have a three-chip LED illuminated projector that probably has one of the best contrast ratios of any front projection system I've seen. Saturated color, beautiful.
I sell my truck, buy a projector.
I'm also pinging LG as well to get their, was it the Hecto? Mm-hmm. I think it is, and that is their laser-based front projector. Yeah. That's another one where I'm really curious to see somebody do consumer laser, because you have such controllable color, such good saturation, and when it turns off, it's pure black. So you're not dealing with a blocked light system. It's just the light goes out, and then so when you need to create black, you can create a very dark black, and that's what gets you the really good contrast ratios.
So a whole bunch of projector reviews coming this fall. Meanwhile, a viewer named Murdog emailed us about projectors and how much is too much light. He says, I've watched pretty much all of the streams you've done on projectors, but the comments on using in a low light environment isn't very helpful. I understand that dozens of variables, wall color, geographic location, weather conditions, window treatment, and on, short of buying a light meter, when a room is dark enough, standing next to a wall shows no shadow, too dark to read a Windows printer test sheet, unable to walk around the room without a flashlight, any universal everyday test to know if a room is too bright for a projector. Short answer, if you can read a book, it's probably too bright. If you can see your furniture, it's probably not too bright. If you can barely see your furniture, you're probably in the neighborhood. Well, it's kind of funny, right? Because we have this big 12-foot by like 6-foot, 5-foot high window. If it's overcast outside, I can barely see the image on the screen. Now, you know, it's a 4,000 lumen projector I think I'm running.
Pretty bright.
It's pretty bright. But you know what? Lumen ratings are flexible.
Totally.
Now, if you want to actually get scientific.
Totally. You could buy a standalone light meter, but there are a lot of good apps I'm finding out there as well. I have one called Light Meter on Android, and iOS has their own as well. They can provide you with the goodest estimation in terms of how bright or not your particular viewing environment is. Now, with that info in mind, head on over to Projector Central's Calculator Pro tool and look up the projector you are considering, and then go through the different calculations in terms of screen size, projection distance from the screen, and even the screen type, because all of those things will affect the perceived brightness of the image itself.
Yeah, it's kind of funny. When you look at the max room lighting, as you sort of scroll this, the smaller you get the diagonal range, the higher the max room lighting gets. And you're looking at like, what is it? Oh, 3-foot candles is the appropriate range for this.
Totally. And this will let you play around too. It's like, oh, maybe a 120-inch screen just simply won't work with this particular projector. But if I shrink the screen a little bit, it'll basically concentrate the light and produce a brighter image at a given specific distance. Now, moving the projector around changes everything, and that's where the Calculator Pro comes in handy for helping estimate your particular situation.
Yeah, I mean, the problem is if you have a big glass windows and you want the curtains open and the blinds up during the day, you're basically going to need to steal the projector from a drive-in movie theater to be able to see it at 120 inches or larger, even probably 100 inches or larger. You're going to need curtains. You want to use blinds. You want the room as dark as possible. If you want to avoid a grayed out image, you want the room as dark as possible.
Totally. And if you have decent light control, even most projectors nowadays are pumping light out. So if you can control it at all, chances are you'll be able to turn that projector's output down a little bit into its echo mode or something similar to save some electricity and extend the lamp module's life as well. So don't think that you're gonna always have to run this at 100%. Perhaps during the day you will, but at nighttime, you're probably going to want to turn it down a little bit, or at least have a preset ready to go so you're not frying your eyes and make it. You got to make it comfortable when you look at these things. You don't want it too bright.
Yeah. Curtains, people. Curtains. Ladies and gentlemen, that is it for this episode of HD Nation. Please subscribe. Go to revision3.com/HD Nation for all the episodes and all the formats.
Yep. Hey, and email us your questions and comments and tell us what you think. And until next time, thank you for watching.